evening and welcome. I'm Mary Kennedy, the director of the Wingate Museum of Art, and we're delighted to have you here this evening. Tonight's talk is in conjunction with our Walker Evans American Photographs exhibition that's over in the museum and will be there through next Friday. The exhibition is made possible with support from Art Bridges. Other upcoming events here at the Wingate include a lecture next Monday by Professor Josh Glick on Walker Evans and street photography, a panel discussion next Wednesday on vernacular architecture with architecture historian Greg Herman from the U of A, Rachel Patton, executive director of Preserve Arkansas, and architectural photographer Tim Hursley. And our closing reception for all four of our exhibitions will be next Thursday. I encourage you all to come. We'll have Logan Engel will be the DJ. We'll have a dinner buffet. We'll have hands-on activities. We'll have an artist demonstration, so it'll be a lot of fun, okay? Tonight we're delighted to have with us Zora Murff, who is an assistant professor of photography at the University of Arkansas, Fayetteville. Zora received his MFA in studio art from the University of Nebraska in Lincoln and holds a BS in psychology from Iowa State University. His work has been exhibited nationally and internationally. In 2019, Murff was one of eight artists chosen for the most recent iteration of the Museum of Modern Art's new photography series, Companion Pieces, New Photography 2020. A selection of his works was also included in the 2021 Paris International Photography Fair. Murff's books include his most recent monograph, True Colors, or Affirmations in a Crisis, published by the Aperture Foundation, as well as At No Point in Between in 2019, Lost Omaha in 2018, and Corrections in 2015. Murff's photographs have also been published in Aperture Magazine, The New Yorker, Vice Magazine, The British Journal of Photography, and The New York Times. Following tonight's lecture, there'll be a reception in the lobby, and I hope you'll join us. Now let's give Zora a warm Hendrix welcome.
Can everybody hear me all right? All right, perfect. Thank you for coming this evening. Very excited to be here. Nice, intimate crowd this evening. And I guess we're all in for a good show. So let's just go ahead and get started.
How it happened before. The places that I knew were sunny and blue. I can feel it deep inside. This black nigger's grind. I have no fear when I say, and I say every day, every nigger is a star. Every nigger is a star. Who would have thought you would die? Every nigger is a star.
All right. So we are here for some jive conspiracy or three acts. These are some reflections on my work through the words of Bobby Seale. Act one, we are here for some jive conspiracy.
All right, we here for some jive conspiracy. You know what we gonna do?
We are going to defend ourselves, because Huey P. Newton said that power is the ability to define phenomena and make it act in a desired manner. Power is the ability to define phenomena and make it act in a desired manner. What kind of phenomena? Social phenomena. What is is a social phenomenon. Black people, Mexican American, any kind of people, begins to learn that the social phenomenon is that, in fact, U.S. racist, decadent, capitalist, imperialist America is a police state. That a police state exists here, that these pigs are doing nothing but protecting the avaricious businessman and the demagogic politician, protecting the exploiting system that they got going. That in fact, we are tired of it, we are sick of it, you've been brutalizing black people, you've been murdering and lynching them, black people are tired of it. Black people are the vanguard of this revolution all of a sudden, and it's phenomenally correct also, but we are concerned with that social phenomena. We are concerned with that exploitation. We are concerned with the oppression that black people and all other peoples in the world who are suffering the same common oppression that we are suffering today. The thing is that we have the ability to define it. If we have the ability to define it, the only next thing to do is get organized. Get organized. So when a pig walks up to you, or a pig gets a job with the people, you'd be so organized, you'd be learning some tactics, you'd be learning some revolutionary principles, you'd be having some guns hit out somewhere, you have some proper tactics. That when the pig gets a job with you, the pig gets wrong, you whoop your guns out on him, blow him away, and then you have the ability, in fact, you have made that pig act in a desired manner.
But for what? But for what? For a new system, brother. We need a new system. The people need a new system.
We are concerned with the oppression that black people and all other peoples in the world who are suffering the same common oppression that we are suffering. So I'm going to talk tonight about my work at No Point in Between, some work that I made between the years 2015 and 2018. I describe At No Point in Between as a chronicle of my life between these years. More particularly, it was a time when I was using the camera and images to answer questions I had about my own existence inside of a racialized society. The work touches on one of the many forms of gun violence in the United States, violence against black people done by killer cops. In the work, I take disparate moments throughout history to make synonymous the many modes of violence, physical, psychic, and political, used to maintain anti-blackness as the dominant social order. Tonight, we'll look at all of these disparate, we'll look at a chain of disparate events in chronological order to reveal how anti-black violence has shifted, changed, and remained internalized. The historian Khalil Gibran Mohammed provides an analysis of the beginnings of how policing of black individuals became a part of American life through policy. He states, in 1835, Louisiana enacted the Slave Patrol Statute, which mandated that slave patrols are to arrest any slave or slaves, whether with or without permit, who may be caught in the woods or forest with any flame or torch. Which slave or slaves thus arrested will be subject to corporal punishment, not exceeding 30 stripes or whiplashes. In that early legislation, we can see that there was a fear of rebellion and uprising, and that these policing practices were founded on systemic injustice, but more importantly, the lack of due process that whites were allowed to in the Bill of Rights. Early on, these slave patrols and codes tie together surveillance, the deputization of all white men, specifically as officers, and all white people, more broadly as reporters, and the ability to dispense corporal punishment on the scene. Slave patrols were some of America's first police forces, created with the sole intent of controlling enslaved black people. So my primary thesis as an artist is the plurality of the image, which was spurred by Alan Sekulis' theory of the shadow archive, or photographically recorded and archived information that possesses multiple meanings based on the person interpreting the image and the context in which that reading is taking place. As a social object, images are made, witnessed, and used inside of different time contexts, creating the opportunity for discourse and the generation of new knowledge. This means that images have the ability to be decontextualized, and it is here where I find my particular area of interest. The image's possibility to vacillate between an object for harm and a tool for liberation. This image was made to serve pseudoscience and to do the work of making blackness other. However, the same image provides concrete evidence that white people will do gruesome things to legitimize oppression for their own benefit. Surveillance, the deputization of all white people, and the ability to dispense corporal punishment on the scene. On September 25th, 1919, Agnes Lobeck, a white woman, reported to police that she was raped by a black man. The next day, police arrested Will Brown, a black man, as a suspect. Lobeck identified Brown as her rapist. There was an unsuccessful attempt to lynch Brown the day that he was arrested. The media sensationalized Lobeck's story, and on the 28th, a mob between 5,000 to 15,000 people laid siege on the Douglas County Courthouse where Brown was being held. Cops released Brown to the mob. The mob lynched him, shot him, and dragged his body through the streets of downtown Omaha. They set him on fire, and this image was made. This type of story, a white woman being raped by a black man, was a common undertone of spectacle lynchings from this era. However, they are rooted in conflicts related to the migration of black people south to north. 3 weeks before this riot, federal investigators had noted that a clash was imminent between blacks and whites, owing to ill feeling between white and black workers in the Omaha stockyards. Surveillance, the deputization of all white people, and the ability to dispense corporal punishment on the scene. In 1969, Vivian Strong was with a group of friends playing music and dancing inside of a vacant apartment. The police were called to break up the party, and when they arrived, Vivian made a break for the back door. As she was running away, police officer James Loder shot her in the back of the head. Surveillance, the deputization of white people, and the ability to dispense corporal punishment on the scene. When James Loder was acquitted, riots erupted in North Omaha, the city's predominantly black neighborhood. My mom's boyfriend, Robert, was murdered by our neighbor in a racially motivated fight when I was 14 years old. Surveillance, the deputization of all white people, and the ability to dispense corporal punishment on the scene. The first time I visited North Omaha, I felt a sense of affirmation in the sense that, you know, I didn't have any inkling or desire to photograph this neighborhood and the people who live there, to talk about its many histories and how it, its particular narratives in this American narrative of anti-black oppression. But I felt affirmed. I was walking down the street, just looking around, and I saw another black person walking down the street. And as they walked by, they said to me, "What's up, black man?" And this was like the first time that I had that feeling of belonging in this space. When I moved to Nebraska, and so that feeling, that experience, it's what drew me into wanting to know more about this place where I felt comfortable, where I felt at home. And when I started talking with other people about it, they had differing opinions, that it was marked as this really bad place. And that conflict of opinion was really interesting to me and sort of the inception point of making this work. Around the same time, I had decided that Let me back up. The footage, the police dash cam footage from the murder of Laquan McDonald, a teenager in Chicago, was released to the public. And I was familiar with instances like this. You know, I grew up hearing stories about Rodney King, like Tamir Rice, Michael Brown. You know, I was familiar with all of these stories. I knew that they made me feel some type of way, but I didn't really know what they meant to me. You know, that I was making and studying photographs so intensely, I decided that I was going to follow this image, all the way through the court case and figure out what this moment meant to me. This is one of the first photographs that I made in North Omaha. It's titled Stick Picks by the Boys for Margaret. And it's an inside joke it's an inside joke with and named after one of my undergrad professors, Margaret Stratton, because it was this sort of inside joke between she and I. And I remember while I was making this image, I was thinking about how she was one of the first people to teach me that photographing from a place of social concern is an act of love. And so, you know, I didn't know what to photograph quite yet, and so I just made this image for me and for her. So I started wondering about the landscape of North Omaha, specifically because it was a place that, you know, I was told it's the hood, it's the ghetto, you know, be careful while you're there photographing, it's dangerous, the college that's nearby the neighborhood, the college students there call the McDonald's that's in the neighborhood, they call it Crack Donald's. So again, all of these negative perceptions about this place, but then also the physical makeup of the neighborhood, like the architecture, the infrastructure, was all eroding. You know, you have shuttered buildings, shuttered houses, condemned houses, empty lots, things, you know, where you could tell something was there before, but for some reason or another, the landscape had changed over time and had started to erode and decay. And so I wanted to know more about that. And so I started doing research to figure out exactly how a neighborhood comes to look this way. And I came across the process of redlining, which in the United States is the process by which banks and other institutions refuse to offer mortgages or offer worse rates to customers in certain neighborhoods based on their racial and ethnic composition. It's this phenomena that's occurring when lenders or insurers are targeting specific places that are non-white with the intent of making loans or insurance unaffordable. So what that does is it creates a system where the people living in those neighborhoods don't have the economic means to reinvest in their immediate surroundings, invest in the businesses, you know, patronize the businesses that exist there. And then it also discourages anyone outside of who doesn't live there from the outside to decide to invest in these places. And so this is a homeowner's loan corporation redlining map of Chicago, Illinois, that was made between the years of 1935 and 1940. So you see on this map different colored areas geographically. And that color, the different colors dictate value. And so this is, you know, a history that, North Omaha didn't escape from. These maps are made by homeowner loan corporation assessors using data and evaluations organized by local real estate professionals, lenders, developers, appraisers, to assign grades to residential areas that reflected their, like, what the value of that place is. So
on the map, you see these different colored areas that have these different letters. The key next to it shows what each of those colors mean. So green being first grade, red being fourth grade. First grade meaning like a prime area that you want to invest in. D being a place that you don't want to invest in. And so this is a map that was made, again, between 1935 and 1940. And the D, the area with the D in the middle, that's pink, that's North Omaha, the neighborhood at that time. And so, you know, I found these maps, and so it's this tangible thing that's telling me about what it is that I'm seeing, what it is that I'm understanding. And so, you know, I knew that there had to be some language that existed to inform how these maps were made, and I kept digging until I found this publication, the Underwriting Manual, which was published by the Federal Housing Administration and, you know, supported the practices of redlining through government policy and is very explicit in how the HOLC could use racial makeup as a way to segregate neighborhoods. And so the snippet on the snippet from the text here reads, if a neighborhood is to retain stability, that property shall continue to be occupied by the same social and racial classes. A change in social or racial occupancy generally leads to instability and a reduction in values. And so, you know, what they're saying is if socioeconomic makeup of a neighborhood changes, the neighborhood's going to decrease in value. If you have a change in racial populations, you know, from white to any group that's non-white, you're going to have a change in values. Again, this policy dictating how people invest their money disenfranchises other people, you know, all thanks to the federal government of the United States of America. And so it was with all of this knowledge that I started photographing in North Omaha. And a lot of the work was just me visiting and just walking around with my camera and trying to find the visual language of redlining and then using my camera as a way to give it visual definition. I started thinking more critically about the landscape and my own interaction with it. I was living in Lincoln, Nebraska at the time, which is 45 minutes from North Omaha, and I was actually traveling on the interstate to get to North Omaha. And again, through research, learning that I was traveling on a piece of infrastructure that was critical to the economic decline in this neighborhood. So in 1969, the North Freeway, which is the freeway that runs through North Omaha, it was slated to be built through a white neighborhood, but white citizens decided that they didn't want that and you know, that the city should put it through the black neighborhood instead. And the city obliged those citizens. This led to a 30% housing loss in the neighborhood and was a really critical moment because a lot of people, rather than deciding to stay there, you know, that were the people who were paid, you know, for right of way, they just decided to leave. So you have, you know, families who, you know, were, you know, generationally from this neighborhood who, you know, just decided that it was time to go. And so you lose all of these people, you know, who had history in this place. And then, you know, the other thing that it does is it creates a further economic stranglehold because all of the traffic that used to drive through the main thoroughfare of the neighborhood, you know, people would stop and patronize businesses in the neighborhood. You know, the interstate diverts all of that traffic around to suburbs farther north. So again, this way of further oppressing this community. And so, you know, with these images, specifically, I was just thinking about, it was like trying to get to this metaphoric place, you know, how do I sort of wreck this structure? You know, how do I illustrate, you know, my feelings towards, you know, how infrastructure and policy are used to manipulate situations to some people's benefits and other people's detriment. And then this actually led me to the act of appropriation inside of this work. And so, you know, the state archives, the Nebraska State Archives are at the University of Nebraska-Lincoln where I was studying. And so it was really nice as a student to have access to all of this history that was informing my work. And so when I was thinking about the freeway specifically, I decided, you know, it would be really great if an aerial image of the freeway cutting through the neighborhood as it's being built would be sort of a good image inside of the work. And so I found the set of imagery from the documentation of the construction of the freeway. But the sort of aerial image I was looking for didn't exist. And, you know, while that was disappointing, it also, like, just led me to kind of expand my practice in this way, where I just started looking for images, aerial images of freeways built through Black neighborhoods. And I found this one that was made at the same time in the late 60s. But this image is from San Antonio, Texas, but it's the documentation of a freeway being built through a Black neighborhood there. And so while this image isn't, you know, in this sort of objective truth way tied to this place, these narratives are one and the same and actually show the breadth of this experience inside of the United States. You know, any major city, Chicago, LA, San Antonio, Houston, Dallas, you know, Miami, New York City, you know, all of these places, they have these similar histories. And more often than not, you know, there's this commonality of a freeway either being built through it or being built around it. And so that act of appropriation, again, expanded the way that I was thinking about how I could use images to, I guess, narrate this story, so to speak. And so, you know, I wanted to honor these local histories, you know, of Will Brown and Vivian Strong inside of the work. And it was like sort of the same, you know, situation with the freeway. You know, I was looking for portraits of Will Brown, and there's not very many that exist. This is like one of the few that I found in a local newspaper that was published after his lynching. And I wasn't quite satisfied with the sort of aesthetics of it. You know, it was very grainy, very low resolution. But I wanted to, again, like have this way of honoring both of them inside of the work. And so then I just borrowed the image and made it into sort of something completely new. So, you know, I took this digital image, I made it into a negative. I made these contact prints from the negatives through sheets of dirty glass, took that silver gelatin, scanned it back to be a digital image, and then did some further manipulation digitally. And these are what I came up with. So the titles being All Our Eclipses Bright, Will Brown, and Vivian Strong. But I feel like, you know, like this, it was like all of the handwork in the process to me was a way of honoring these two individuals and was a way of maybe offering them something past victimhood. And so then I, you know, continued that act of appropriation. So this is a recreation of that lynching photograph that you saw earlier. You know, this And this was a tough image to work with, because I knew that it said a lot, you know, thinking back to Alan Sekulow's shadow archive, you know, this information that exists inside of an image, you know, these multiple stories that exist, but it, you know, takes a critical reading. And so I, you know, as I was looking at the image, I just started thinking my way through how I was looking at it. You know, in its original form, you have, you know, Will Brown's mangled body, you know, set on fire. You have this crowd of white men standing over him, posing for the camera. And it's really easy to get caught up looking at Will Brown's body, you know, thinking about this horrific violence, thinking about the victim. But again, there's this group of men who were all willingly posing and solidifying an evidence that they are complicit in this act, that they took part in it, that they didn't do anything to intervene or stop it. You know, and it also, you know, this, it shows, it sort of reflects the values of our society at the time. Again, this evidentiary object, people saying, I was here and I did this. Three of the men in this image were tried. And all of them were acquitted, even though, again, there's proof that they took part in this act. And so by cropping the image, it's just me redirecting the gaze, which, you know, is something that in the history of spectacle lynching, you know, a trick that's sort of used to get people to think past, you know, the horrific part of the image and look at what's really there. Anti-lynching organizations would do the same thing, where they would reprint these images in their own publications, but they would provide language that would read, don't look at the victim, look at the crowd of people. Like, what horror is being wrought in the minds of these people? What type of citizen, you know, does witnessing these acts lead to? You know, this image being sort of an echo of that, thinking about, you know, American police forces, their inception, you know, these murders of black people that happen at the hands of police, and really just, again, making these very crucial visual connections as a way of building a particular context. And solely through image, you know, like kind of touching on this, I guess, like using appropriation in pursuit of highlighting these multiple truths that exist inside of these images. And so this image being that, a screen capture of the moment right before Laquan McDonald was murdered by police officer Jason Van Dyke. You have enacted your power to define phenomena and make it act in a desired manner. So I'm going to read a couple of things. The first one comes from the book of this work, At No Point in Between, which at the reception, if you'd like to see the copy of the book, see a copy of it, you know, you can feel free. But there's two pieces of writing that I commissioned for this work. Both really good friends of mine, one by my friend Terrence, which I'm going to read first, and then I'll read the second writing by my friend Lisa here in a second. So this writing is titled, What Do I Need to Wreck a Structure? Let us dig into the unspeakable and linger in the time we lost, to clock violence at its various speeds. For one thing, it's time. To show my face, to be composite. Memorials of black and white and young living men saying stay up and I love you as goodbyes. The narrative is me or mine and not both. Or is it ours? Let my very being tear the roof off that motherfucker. Syncopate the status quo by breathing. And a young boy, I love you, please stay up, with a basketball under his arm, and what light in that hand. to show my face here in the hands of those who bought me, there in the array of arms raised to preserve an order? What do I need to wreck a structure? What is an individual in this structural context? Why must I feel like that? Light through the cracks, through its cracks, offbeat and on time. Light through the leaves, blood on them, and off my green shoulders, into the cracks of the pavement, and to rather let the funk be your guiding light through the leaves than to be the tree, to rather make a living of a life than to be still, and when there isn't a radical living or dead who never said I, when there may not be one who never spoke, even though to speak, to think, is to be in time, and to be in time is to crumble. The most radical thing is to choose time and its distension, to choose the question of the self and its profusion, to choose the problem and possibility of connection. A young woman, I love you, with the bearing of royalty and goldenrod and speckled. Imagine meeting a person and calling it yours. Then imagine believing personhood is decided by law rather than birth itself. An object with a family and a mind gets the vote in 1870 and 2025, and then the fear of retribution. No, rather, water between the bricks, shrinking and swelling with ordered time, or within it to break order and its status as cement. Your children dance on broken floorboards to the sounds of revenge, that mere breath, stay up. To rather be the salt in the wound, to rather crack time open and fill, what is it to think one needs to own people? And where does the need go when the possibility of ownership is legislated away? And if blood is thicker than water, then let us seep. Let us make the rubble home. And now I'll read from Lisa Reardon Saville's afterword from At No Point in Between. In the beginning, there was a boy, bright and dimpled and full of light. He was born to a place around which men had drawn a red line to circumscribe dreams. Nevertheless, life there unfurled like petals through concrete. The father of the boy knows two things. His son will be too often looked at and too little seen. There will be forms to record the boy's name, his aliases, and alleged deeds. None will note the precise timbre of his laugh, how his face goes soft when he is quiet, the grace with which, when he is old, if he gets to be old, he will rest a heavy ringed hand on his knee. So those who love him would find their own way to record his beauty. Don't write about the work, you tell me. Write around it. In another beginning, there was another boy. He was born in bondage and died a free man. At some point in between, he saw that light and chemistry not only captured an image, but conjured a world. He turned himself into the most photographed man in what were not yet and may never be these United States. Frederick Douglass believed that a certain kind of picture could twist the story that this country had whispered itself to sleep with. So he dressed up and pressed up against hypocrisy and said, "Behold." Even as he sat to have his picture made, he saw that it would be subject to what he called the wild scramble between contending interests and forces. It will either lift us to the highest heavens or sink us to the bottomless depths, he wrote, understanding perhaps before anyone else did that this country would war over the photograph much as it battled over itself. 152 years after Douglass lectured on pictures, a 17-year-old boy was shot to death by police on Chicago's southwest side. Months would pass before most of us knew his name, which we would learn as we watched him twirl. This gesture I cannot free from my mind. We watched him twirl, and then we watched him die. The police officer said that the boy with erratic eyes lunged with a knife in his hand, and that's why he pulled the trigger. 16 entrances, 16 exits, 24 wounds. At the trial 4 years later, the boy's uncle would describe this as death by a thousand cuts. The system left a story written in the boy's file. In it, the mother was neglectful and her son near broken. The boy wrote around it. He turned his body into his scripture, left language inked upon his skin. On his right hand were the words, "Good son." On his left, the reminder, in four capital letters, that you only live once. Just below a bridge between the wounds from bullets 6 and 7, his name, Quan. It was you who introduced me to the term slow violence, the thousand creeping cuts, the suspension, the stub, the side eye, the hurt pressed into bones, the denied bank loan, the dream turned to rubble, the too many dead ends on the top and bottom of family trees. I think of the bridge between violence fast and slow when I read that in the days after Laquan McDonald died, a pair of witnesses, a father and son, said that their picture of what happened that night did not accord with the story the police union told. It took me a few days to work up the strength, the nerve to call somebody and report it, the father later said. I couldn't sleep. It was eating away at me and my conscience. It was killing me. 13 months later, when we saw Laquan not lunge at the officer who pulled out his gun, the police union admitted that the lunging is not visible. There is no lunging visible in the video itself. What was not visible would become its own evidence when the defense, carrying on the wild scramble, told the jury, "The clip that you saw of the shooting, it doesn't tell the whole story." There's no such thing as a photograph without a story. So much of art can be spun from imagination's thread, but a photograph proclaims at least a tacit connection to truth. In time, the tale may be lost, but for a shuddering blink, it was there. There, too, is everything beyond the frame, and everything that happened before, and everything that would follow. In that unseen, a photograph is made and remade. At moments, I tell you, these photographs crush me. The golden hush settling across the street, how when she turns her face to the light, she glows. Your sampling of history and the way silence speaks between. I want to call what I see beauty, but what I think I mean is love. Because it is a kind of love when a people who know observation can imperil say, "I will let you look at me." And when you stand behind the lens and say, "I see you." A love in seeing in someone else's eyes that red lines were one of the many lies told to fix the image. And that black people have always written around them and through them and all over the top. There's something I've been writing around, writing myself in circles for the same reason I'm not entirely sure I should be the one writing this at all. Because something else reflected here that maybe I'd rather not see. For a long while, I look at the man at the center of the photograph, shirt starched and bright white behind the haze of smoke. The bend of his arm, fist resting on his hip, his smile that says, "Look at me." I ask myself what it takes to perpetrate a casual act of photography amid the smell of burning flesh. But I do not ask why I do not see myself among the faces in the crowd. I could come up with reasons other than the truth, which is that because they are white and I am white, I can convince myself our stories are not conjoined. I can write around it. I know that is a failure of sight. In the beginning, you and I were born into this place. Ours is a country that would force you to see your outlines in the body of a boy shot to death on Chicago's southwest side, and absolved me from recognizing mine in the lyncher's smile. That blindness means that I struggle to find language to tell this story while you speak it in registers. I won't lie to you. There's a part of me when I look at the woman with dark skin and pink lips and arms thick like mine that wants to ask for a forgiveness she does not owe me. Give me a chorus to repeat so I don't have to articulate my own reckoning. She looks back at me, but she remains silent. In the end, the defense tried its best to use the mother's words against her son. She refused to speak. When I go looking, the photograph I find is of the boy smiling shy beneath a red mortarboard, a long hand not yet grown into holding a rolled diploma. I envision the family wrung out from knowing that too many strangers watched their boy take his last breath, sifting through the snapshots to find the one that delivers his memory. Behold, this you can have of him. The rest we will keep.
Let me understand this. You two came here to question me?
Well, your attitudes, Mr. Endicott, your points of view are a matter of record. Some people, well, let us say the people who work for Mr. Colbert might reasonably regard you as the person least likely to mourn his passing. We were just trying to clarify some of the evidence. Was Mr. Colbert ever in this greenhouse, say, last night about midnight?
Gillespie? Yeah. You saw it.
I saw it.
But what are you going to do about it?
I don't know.
I'll remember that. There was a time when I could have had you shot.
That's it. Thank you. Yeah. Well, yeah. I always try to leave a little bit of time for Q&A.
Do people want to jump in? I just want to say that scene with Sidney Poitier from In the Heat of the Night. So for those of you that don't know this film, it's the story of this, he's a detective that goes to this southern town, and he's assisting them in trying to discover this murder. But I just recently read Sidney Poitier's biography, and when they made that movie, it wasn't written for him to slap the guy back. You know this already. It wasn't written for him to slap the guy back, but he insisted that was the case, and that's sort of the guy he was. And so they kept it in there, but even, I mean, the film was made in like 1969. Even at that moment, it was still like controversial that he would slap him back. Oh. It was amazing.
yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I like to show it. It's one of it's a movie I grew up watching with my mom, and like one where I didn't really understand a lot of the subtle messages in the movie until I watched it like a couple years ago again, and was like, oh man, I was like, of course, like as at a young age, just missing so much of the nuance in that film. But sort of a palate cleanser at the end. But yeah. Any questions? Don't be shy. And I'll answer questions about anything and everything, the work and, you know, my practice as an artist, too. Yes?
I just wanted to ask about your book. Like, so is it, like, mostly your photos, or, like, do you have, like, writing in it? Or you read some of the writing included by your friends, but... Mm-hmm.
So no, not in this book. In this book, it's I only appear by putting photographs in it. In this newer book that I just published, I have like my own writing in it. But this work, when I made it, it was my graduate thesis work. You can dig through the UNL thesis archives and you can actually find the paper. I wasn't ready to write like about my work or even alongside my work. I think that was something that like at the time I still had a lot to figure out, like what I would actually say in writing. I think that, you know, what the process of commissioning writing from other people, it really opened me up to collaborating with others and really just relinquishing this sort of sense like, you know, I'm, you know, like the only expert about my work. And, you know, so one of the things in Lisa's writing, she says, you know, like she wrote, you know, her afterword sort of in this way where she's talking to me. And so like as the reader, you just get to be privy to her talking to me. But when I asked her to write the essay, she asked like, well, like, what do you want me to do? Like, what do you want me to write? And I was like, well, I don't want to give you a lot of rules. And so the only rule I'm going to give you is to write around the work. Don't write about it. You know, I didn't want to read something where it was, you know, like, I guess like kind of like picking apart images or, you know, like trying to like do like this critical connecting between the histories. I just wanted it to be, you know, a dear friend's personal reflection on what they were seeing by just looking at the work, you know, looking at the book, how it was constructed, thinking about the content. And so she just gave me her like legitimate reaction, which I thought was like, it turned out really beautiful how it turned into this conversation. And so the same with my friend Terrence, you know, he's a curator, but he also writes. You know, he was thinking like when I asked him originally, that he was expecting like, you know, again, some sort of like maybe, you know, kind of research-based kind of essay. And I just asked him like, well, what do you want to write? And he's like, well, I really like writing poetry, but no one ever really asks me to write, you know, poetry. And so I was like, well, write your essay in poetry format. And that's exactly what he did. If you're going to stick around for the reception, I have a, you know, this copy here. I would really like suggest that you just take a look through. Other questions?
You were talking about the highways kind of bisecting through like neighborhoods, and I guess you're aware of 630 heading through Little Rock, mm-hmm. and what it destroyed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, right. But I think it's again like that, you know, a lot of places aren't, you know, exempt from, you know, this history. And, you know, I'm from the Midwest, you know, I know the Midwest, but, you know, when you hear about stories like this or you see artists, you know, approaching the subject matter, it's never coming from the middle, it's rarely often seen from the middle of the country. I think that, like, yeah, that, you know, I found out, you know, I educated myself about this phenomena, you know, through, you know, like the landscape of the Midwest. Just like sort of expanding like that this happened virtually everywhere in the country. And is even like being a tactic now being used internationally in other countries. Very ubiquitous history. Yeah. Yes.
I have a comment and a question. So in the New York Times today, there's an article where I don't know the writer's name, but has done the research to look at wrongful death charges against police How much various cities have to pay to defend, cops that are violating people's human rights. And the compilation was $1.5 billion. Mm-hmm. Once they looked at this, across all of these communities, because it's largely kept confidential by individual communities, that it's actually, present and a very costly problem, just for cities from a financial perspective to be in that position. But I was shocked by that number, that there were that many cases, that there were that many wrongful deaths, wrongful assaults, that kind of thing. I thought it was just an amazing statistic that I was just shocked by. I did want to ask you though, so for the series, you showed a lot of historical documents. You talked about your experience in North Omaha. You showed us some of the images, but I think for the students, it'd be interesting to understand how you conceive of a project like this. Mm-hmm. What came first? How mm-hmm. did these parts come together? That sort of thing. Mm-hmm.
It was just really like, it was the culmination of a lot of different experiences, which is why I feel I try to preface the work as, a very limited view of things that I was thinking about, between the years 2015 and 2018. Because there's like the work itself, right? But there's all of the things that the, viewers typically aren't privy to, like what goes into the making of a project, right? So, it's like sort of me having like this, kind of becoming consciously, like more consciously aware of, like what does it mean to be, Black in America? What are the ways like I have to be cautious in particular environments? And then visiting North Omaha and like all of that just fading, because it was a space where I always felt acknowledged, I always felt safe, people like would actually like engage me, it was like a very friendly place like for me to photograph. I think that like, so that Laquan McDonald footage and following his case. I think deciding, like once I was like sold, like, sold myself on like I was going to pursue this project, it was just a matter of like just visiting and looking. So that was like a lot of the process was, I would drive down on weekends, Saturdays and Sundays, either early in the morning or close to the evening, and I would just like, I would drive around the neighborhood. I would just like kind of look at things as I was driving around. Eventually I would like stop somewhere, and then I would start taking pictures, walking around, conversating with random people. Taking more pictures until, I lost the good light, and then I would pack up and then I would drive back home and, process images, process film, all that stuff. And then I'd go out and do it again. And I just kept doing it over and over and over again. With a lot of the projects that I work on, it's, there's been like a natural kind of wrapping up point, as a graduate student, I have to present my thesis. After grad school, I got the job at the University of Arkansas, so I was moving away, and so not photographing in the neighborhood anymore. So it was just a time for me to say, okay, like I think this is just the end of the work as it is right now. And then, I think like it's like a culmination of a lot of things and a lot of following my impulses and a lot of research and digging through archives and looking at, images and information. And then just like letting all of that stew. And I was approached in, late 2018 by the publisher. It was published by Deus Books. It's an independent publisher run by my now friend, Sean Bush. And it was like, I think I really enjoyed the publishing process because it was, again, this collaboration. He was like, I have $10,000. I can make you $10,000 of worth of whatever type of book you want to make. And then it's just about creating, you know, this object that, like, where the concept doesn't disappear inside of the form, right? Like that the book has like a lot of design elements in like the, you know, this is like a leatherette cover. It's very soft and supple, so it's kind of pleasing to touch. You know, I wanted it to, like, when it's sitting out, to kind of feel like a dark, heavy object. So, you know, we decided to do this painted edge. The book cloth material, it's not breathe, like it doesn't breathe. And so the longer that you hold it, your fingerprints, like the condensation, the sweat from your hands, starts to leave a mark on the book. So you're sort of implicating yourself by holding it. Yeah, there's just a lot of different things that went into the design. But again, it was a way of like taking everything that I had thought about for, you know, like 3 years, and then working with somebody through all of that information to make a book that kind of captures the spirit of the work. So yeah, I mean, that's how it all came together, the long and the short of it, I suppose, yeah. But it's like a lot of dedication, a lot of failure. I think that's like another thing as, you know, as artists that, or as viewers, you know, you don't get to see all of the really terrible pictures that I made. But even something as simple as, like, you know, the portraits that I make. You know, I started photographing, like when I was making this work, I started making the portraits with a large format camera. But I quickly realized that was the wrong camera for the work, because of how cumbersome it is and the process of trying to, like, get somebody to pose. Every portrait just came out really stiff. And then I switched to just using my digital camera. The portraits got a little better, but they just didn't really, like, they still just weren't quite there. And then one of my professors bought a medium format camera, a Mamiya RZ67 for the school. And he was like, give this camera a shot out. Like, just give it a try, you know, make sure it works, blah, 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 blah. So I, you know, took it out. And, you know, like the first images, like the first portraits that I made, I felt there was something more special about them. And then, you know, the longer, like, I had to think about, like, why there was this dramatic shift, it was because I was no longer putting an object in front of my face. And so as I'm making portraits of people, I can still look them in the eye, and I can still talk to them. Our conversation doesn't get cut off and turn into, like, you know, this, you know, like me trying to pose them, okay, hold that, stay still. You know, I can give direction, you know, like while still being able to acknowledge somebody. And so, you know, I think that trial and error, that failure, you know, sort of led to being able to make these really strong, beautiful portraits of people. So this one is a large format portrait. This is like the only large format portrait that I got to work. But I think it's because Gerard is, like, you know, holding his son, and that's, yeah, like he's, you know, very, you know, like tenderly holding his kid. But yeah.
Can you tell us where at the point in between the title comes from?
Yeah, so the title, it's like this, it comes from a quote where somebody, like on a podcast I was listening to, was talking about how race is perceived, and how it's often, like, perceived as either or. You're either this or you're either that. There's no, like, you know, there's no spectrum in between. And they were talking about that, and they said, at no point in between shall you exist. And that just kind of stuck with me. You know, that I was photographing you know, a landscape that I was photographing, geography. I think it had this nice sort of relationship, this idea of like at no point in between, like this idea of like being somewhere and nowhere. Yeah, so that, yeah, that's where the title comes from. Okay.
So your presentation is sort of multimedia, you bring in lots of different writers, even the background's interesting, the video, all of that. Have you ever been able to exhibit and use all those different kinds of components to create the effect you want, or do you, when you exhibit, do you just show still photographs?
Well, when I exhibit, I've just shown, like, you know, artworks. You know, I do other things, like I make sculpture, I do assemblage, I do some collage here and there. I'm trying to learn how to paint. It's not going very well, but hopefully I'll fail my way into something good. Yeah, like I haven't had the chance to like try this maybe more multimedia approach in a space. I'm hoping that, like the newer book, True Colors, that like how I present the imagery in that is drastically different from, you know, this book, which is maybe more of a traditional photo book, so to speak, where it's just, you know, images by themselves on pages, where this newer book, it's like I'm collaging like on the spreads and things. It's a lot, like, I guess, more visually diverse, I would say. And I think, like, in the book format, it's maybe, yeah, like, foreshadowing in a way of how I can do, like, something like this, you know, like, with this presentation in a physical space. So, yeah, hopefully soon. We'll see. Yeah, thank you for saying that. And I think that's definitely just a byproduct of Zoom lectures. I mean, when we went into lockdown, like teaching and, you know, like I started booking a lot more visiting artist lectures because it's easier to, you know, bring somebody when they don't actually have to leave their house. But, you know, like just being sort of like sick of the, you know, just like images on a slide and you're talking at people, it gets boring really fast and pandemic world. You know, inspired by my partner Raina, who's also an artist, like she gave a lecture and she did this really cool, like where she, it wasn't like she was telling you information, she was just sort of narrating to herself, and then sometimes there was like audio and sometimes video would play and like moments where she wasn't speaking, and I was like, that's like actually really intelligent, right? Like letting other forms of media speak, right? Letting other forms of media inside of like this compressed format maybe do the talking a little bit more, or allowing like the audience just to kind of sit back for a second and maybe, you know, like just kind of think about what it is that you're hearing, you know, having some time to breathe and think. So yeah, trying it out now back in person. I still have, I think, some things to work out, but I look forward to continuing to evolve the format for sure.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much.
Yeah. Oh, there's one more question. I wanted to get your question before, yeah.
I was just going to ask you if you have any future works or projects that you
would. You know, I just published another book, so right now I'm just coasting, man. I'm not trying to make anything. I'm tired. No, I think I'll just have like some shows and things in the future. And I'm really looking forward to that, like, you know, this newer book, being able to start presenting that in different ways and formats. So, but thank you for your question. And thank you, everybody, for coming. I really appreciate you.